Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of our Farming RPG series. To pick up where we left off, we can build upon the conditions property. But instead of doing it entirely by code, we can switch to the UI Toolkit. If you have worked in web development before, this would be quite familiar to you. So, for starters, I created a new folder, UI Elements, to house the markup UXML and stylesheet USS files. So, we create a new file, blackboardcondition.uxml. This will be the file that will contain all the UI elements that we'll be using. Much like HTML, it's a markup file that allows you to assign classes and IDs to the elements. In this UXML file, we have all the possible fields on here, and we will hide the fields accordingly using class selectors and such. We'll use the style sheet, blackboardconditionStyle.uss, to style the elements. Like the previous part, we will create a property drawer script, blackboard condition editor, to handle the rendering and bind the fields accordingly. UI Toolkit uses uQuery, which is sort of like jQuery for Unity, if you're familiar with jQuery on web. So how it works is that we select the elements by their names. So we will need to ensure that the names on the UXML file matches the corresponding name on the script. So in this case, int value will have to be the same over in the script, int dash value, and so on. Then on the enum values change event, instead of rendering the field from scratch, just like we did in the previous part, what we can do is assign the selected field a special class like selected, and then we have the rendering logic handled by the style sheet. So how the style sheet works is a lot like CSS, but it's Unity. So we can set the display property of blackboard entry value fields to none. So all the fields under this name, blackboard entry value, will be hidden. But then we add another selector in our USS file, selected class, where it would show the element. So when you give the selected class in the script, the selected element would be given the selected class, and then you would see it in the editor. And now we run into the same problem as we had in a previous editor script that we had in the previous part. Whenever we update the value, it can get quite glitchy at times. So we would need to call the handleUtility.repaint function over on GUI. Then I just had to touch up the styling for the elements such that the width is 50% with the comparison operator and the value. So they are all on the same line, so it's a lot neater now. Now And now the blackboard condition property is a lot cleaner and easier to work with. Now on to the meat of today's part, our event system, the cutscenes. So how I wanted it to go was like this. When the player enters the scene, we will retrieve the folder of possible cutscenes from the location the player entered. These cutscenes would be scriptable objects, and we will check this list to find the cutscene that meets all the conditions and select it for playing. So the first step to achieving this is to create the cutscene scriptable object. This will comprise of the conditions needed to trigger it, and a list of actions it will perform once it runs. The cutscene action class is the base class from which all possible actions in the cutscene will be derived from. For now, we will have two types of actions. Actor, for any actions that involves either the NPC or the player, and speech, to handle the dialogue. I wanted the cutscene editor, you know, when you're planning the cutscene, to look a lot like the RPG Maker event editor, so I tried to make it look like that. But for some reason, I could not get it to work, as I could not figure out how to handle the serialization aspect of the class, because all the child classes are having different properties, so I had some problems with serialization. Then I realized it was easier to go about it through nested scriptable objects, which was what a lot of people were already using right now. It's quite a common implementation. So there are already existing tools around that we could just make use of. So to that end, I just changed the cutscene action class to inherit from scriptable object. And then I tried to get an external Unity package, this SO collection, scriptable object collection, to handle the editor rendering instead. Then I realized that it was not just me when I was doing the serialization earlier. I was still getting a lot of errors, and I realized that our current Unity build is a bit bugged on the editor side. So I migrated to Unity 6 Preview. And it worked just fine. So now we can go straight to implementing the cutscene execution. And so I created the cutscene manager to handle the cutscene execution. And it starts from on location load from the scene transition manager, in which the selection process will begin. Now in cutscene manager, we first load up all the cutscenes in the folder of the same name of our current scene. Then we make a function, cutscene2play, that will evaluate each cutscene condition to find a suitable cutscene to play. This is much like our dialogue system. It will find a candidate that meets all conditions. Since our individual condition evaluation is the same as what we had done previously, let's make an iCondition interface that will be shared for both the dialogue condition and our current cutscene class. In the case of our introduction cutscene, which will play when the player first exits his house for the first time, we will be using the blackboard to keep track of whether it has already played. The way our cutscene manager runs a cutscene will be similar to how we did our dialogue system. We'll need the functions start cutscene, update cutscene, and cutscene, along with a queue of all the actions that we need to execute. So what happens when a cutscene first starts? We need time to stop. So we make it so that it is possible in Time Manager to stop the time. Then we also need to disable the player so that he doesn't move around. Update cutscene like in the dialogue system's update, we dequeue the action and run it. And in the end function, we reset whatever we changed back to its original place. Over in cutscene action, I realized that we didn't really need to keep track of the action state, so I got that removed and simply have a callback for when the execution is finished. And then we needed an init function over in cutscene action. So when we initialize an action in the cutscene, we can pass the update cutscene function to be called once the execution of that action is complete. Now we have to code in the individual logic for each action. For the speech action, since we already have the dialogue system in place, we can call the onExecutionComplete callback once the whole dialogue finishes. Actor action is the tricky one, since we will have to keep track of all the NPCs and such. But we don't want our NPCs that normally spawn to interfere with the cutscene, so we will have to create a pause function over in NPC Manager. Track of all the actors that will be around in the cutscene in a dictionary over in Cutscene Manager. And then we'll have code for the logic for adding, removing, and moving an actor, along with clearing all the actors on the scene. I realized that the best component to keep track of would be the NavMesh agent. That way, when the player is in the cutscene, I can just disable all its control and movement components and replace it with a NavMesh agent and have it controlled just like the other NPCs. Then we just need a coroutine that waits until the actor reaches its intended destination before marking the actor action as complete. And with that, we have a basic cutscene system that we can easily expand and build upon. That's it for this part, and we will see you next time.